So, welcome to all the viewers for this evening session of the EduSet session. In this session, we will discuss a very important topic in our course MEC 009, that is Research Methods in Economics. And today's topic is Research Methodology Conceptual Foundation. It pertains to the Unit 5 of Block 2, and the topic is also same, that is Research Methodology Conceptual Foundation. Before beginning on this topic, I would like to discuss the importance of this theme itself. Many students who are pursuing MA Economics program would like to start their career as a researcher, or they would like to go for higher further studies like MPhil or PhD program. So at this level, to motivate such type of students who are willing to join the teaching profession by completing their research degree, they should have a feel what this research is and how to do research for either obtaining MPhil degree or PhD degree, or to join some research institutions and to start research as a career itself. So for this purpose, this course will be very useful. We have actually two options under this course. Either a student can do this, can opt this research methods in economics, MEC 009, or he can also opt for a project work. So after giving this brief introduction, let me come to my topic, that is Research Methodology Conceptual Foundation. First of all, I would like to define what generally we mean by research. Research basically is a search for knowledge. Knowledge, either creation of new knowledge, addition of new knowledge, or to examine the validity of the existing knowledge. That is, there are various theories, various models, whether they might have been formulated 10 years, 20 years back. Do those theories still valid, or whether they have lost their relevance and given the situation and circumstances as the time changes, or still they are valid. So, but creation or search for knowledge by using or by applying a systematic method. Systematic method consists of formulating a research problem, then formulation of a hypothesis, then by making research design, then data collection techniques, data analysis, and then drawing the results. So these are the various steps which are generally followed in any meaningful research. We will take up this separately in the further discussion. But before going to that, let me tell what is the meaning of the research methodology. Generally, students interchange research methods and research methodologies one and same thing, but this is not so. Research methodology is a wider concept. Wider concept in the sense that it includes three components. First component is theoretical perspectives. Second, tools and techniques of data collection. And third, methods of data analysis. What is this theoretical perspectives? Actually, theoretical perspectives means the logic or which guides the research. In research, whether is a defining of a research problem or using a particular method of data collection or analyzing a particular problem, logic is involved. Without logic, a research is not complete. So, research perspectives in theoretical sense includes three things. One is ontological and epistemological assumptions. Second is logic of inquiry. And third is appropriateness of the method of data collection and data analysis. So, theoretical perspectives basically include the epistemological part, theory of knowledge, how to judge a particular theory is valid or invalid, and how to generate the knowledge There are a lot of theoretical school of thought over it. So broadly, these schools of thought can be given under two heads. One famous is empiricism and another is rationalism. In empiricism, basically, induction method is used by observations, concepts are defined, and then a logic is applied, and then conclusions are drawn. In rationalistic approach or under rationalism, basically reasoning is applied, and by reasoning, some unobserved entities are observed, and laws are derived, and theories are formulated. Basically, these theoretical perspectives or different philosophical schools of thought help us to develop the logic for conducting an inquiry. So this is a very important part of research. This is theoretical perspectives. Then why, how a particular data set is being used, a particular data collection technique is being used, a particular data tool is used, why? So whenever you conduct a research, all these logical explanation has to be given by when collecting the data for a particular research problem. Similarly, once data is collected, then one has to analyze the data. There are various techniques of data analysis. So these techniques basically are used, but why a particular data analysis technique is being used, why the data is analyzed in a particular method, that is also important. So that is why research methodology differs in the research from research methods techniques, because here logic plays an important role. Logic at the time of defining the research problem, logic at the time of formulation of a hypothesis, logic at the time of collection of data techniques, and logic also while analyzing the data. So this is a fundamental difference between the research methods basically comprises of two things: data collection techniques and data analysis techniques. So again, I come to, there are two things: research techniques and research tools. What is the difference between two? Research techniques basically includes the method of data collection, how data is collected, either by primary survey method or secondary survey method, and then how data is analyzed. These are basically covered under the research techniques. But research tools, what are the basically instruments for collection of the data? It may be schedule, may be questionnaire, may be interview, may be telephonic interview, may be maps. There are so many tools and texts, diary, historical diaries, and so many things. So these are the research tools. Tools basically we refer to the instruments through which data is collected. And techniques basically we mean the techniques of the data collection, the method of data collection, and the method of data analysis. So after giving this brief introduction of the conceptual things, what is the meaning of the research methodology, what is research method, what is research technique, what are the tools of the data collection, let me come what types of research we have. There are research are various types depending upon the content, method, and so many types of research techniques. But broadly, we will explain in today's discussion descriptive type research and analytical type research, theoretical and applied research, quantitative research, qualitative research, conceptual research, empirical research. Let me come to discuss one by one. What is a descriptive type of research? Generally, descriptive type research refers to fact-finding research basically. Fact-finding means we are not going to analyze a particular problem is there. We have to find out what is the problem. For example, if in a particular area we want to know what is the level of poverty in a particular district, a researcher or investigator's job is to quantify the poverty level. Say another example, suppose if there is a flood in Bihar, and a researcher will go what, how people are being affected there, how many people are being affected there, how many property or what sort of economic damage has taken place. All this type of fact-finding inquiry are covered under the descriptive research. But if the research has to be analytical, then a researcher's job is little bit more difficult and complicated. He has to use the not only the data at the place, rather the so many other data information to analyze. Let me give another example. If a researcher goes in the field and he has to analyze why this poverty has happened, so the term, the question why is more important in the analytical research. He has to go in the field, he has to analyze whether the poverty is due to the lack of assets or due to the lack of adequate employment opportunities or due to lack of land holdings or due to floods, or there are so many reasons. So he has to analyze what is the level of income, what is the assets, what is the health, what is their employment position. Then he will relate the variables. Is there a relationship between poverty is due to the lack of assets? Then he has to examine the size of the family and family wise assets and so many things. So in analytical research, basically the relationship between the variables and the in terms of independent and dependent variable, one variable is done. For example, poverty may be considered, level of poverty is a dependent variable, and there are so many explanatory variables like income, assets, employment days, and so many things. In the previous discussion, two variable model, multivariable regression models were used. So all these types of variable regression models are used in analytical research. Now let me come to the another type, theoretical and applied research. Sometimes the existing theories are questioned. They do not match with the reality. So some sort of weaknesses, some sort of which the theory doesn't explain the reality. So questions are posed whether this theory is correct or not. So examining the existing theories, that may be one part, and then sometimes a theory is lacking altogether. There are so many problems and arise in practical life, but some theories do, or there is no theory explaining a particular phenomena. So the researchers develop a particular theory, so that is known as a theoretical research. Sometimes there are maybe some problems. Before the researcher, there may be a problem like unemployment problem. Why unemployment is there? A researcher or a policy maker wants to solve the unemployment problem. So the simple, first he will try to find out, to identify the factors which led to the unemployment problem. So such type of research, which basically problems of day-to-day life, real life, so if research is focused to find out the solution, such type of research are known as the applied research. Then another type of research may be quantitative or qualitative. This is a very important classification of research. Quantitative research is basically based on the quantitative phenomena or the measurement of a particular phenomena. For example, if we want to relationship if between the consumption and the income, so the level of the consumption expenditure and the level of income, what type of relationship exists between these two, whether as the income increases, consumption also increases, or the level of consumption is much higher among the higher income groups. So what is the consumer behavior? All types of research where a phenomena is measured in terms of number or in terms of quantity, it is known as a quantitative research. But qualitative research is basically related to the qualitative phenomena. We would like to know what are the particular motives, attitudes of people about a particular thing. If we want to examine the performance of any particular scheme or program, or the quality of a particular course material in our context of IGNU, or so many things. So that thing that is known as a qualitative research. So this is quantitative and qualitative are also research approaches, so we will discuss later on, we will come on this part. But let me come to another part of research, that is conceptual and empirical research. Sometimes in the beginning, a researcher wants to develop some concepts. He wants to explain a particular phenomena. Then what he does do, that he develops some concepts. He observes the things and tries to define the nature or the essence of a particular thing. Such type of research is known as a conceptual research. Empirical research basically examines whether a particular theory or a particular law, how it fits with the reality. Whether a particular theory is really reflects the reality, or a particular theory explains the phenomena in real life situation, such type of research is known as an empirical research. For example, a particular theory, for there is a psychological of consumption, which states that as the income increases, consumption also increases, but in less proportion rather than the increase in the income. So meaning thereby that the proportion of the expenditure spent on the consumption decreases with the increase in income. If this is a theoretical formulation or a psychological law of consumption, and whether does it found in the reality, does it found with the experience, does it found with the real life situation, then a researcher would like to examine by applying, by collecting first data, and then by applying the statistical tools, particularly econometric models, then he will find whether a theory is fit, the theory is true, or whether the theory reflects the reality in the day-to-day situation. So this type of research is known as empirical research. There are many other types of research, like historical research, when historical facts and evidences are used. Similarly, there may be exploratory research for examining a particular, for framing a particular hypothesis. There may be a clinical research and so many types of research. But in the subject like economics, broadly, the four types of research which I have explained to you is conducted. So after coming to this type of research, let me proceed further. Research process. This is an important part, practical part. Many students who either complete their MPhil program or PhD program or to do the project work, they are expected first to prepare a synopsis. So how to prepare a synopsis? Basically, the research process throws light that part. The most important part in framing a research proposal is, the first of all, how to define the research problem. Generally, students come to us, sir, on what topic we should do the research. Will it be this topic will be all right? Similarly, many students come for the research project, on what topic we should do the project work. So this is an important part. The first issue is that how to define the research problem. The first thing is that a candidate or a research student first should identify his area of interest. Maybe broader area of interest, maybe agriculture, maybe industry, maybe labor economics, trade, environment, employment, so many things. So first of all, he is supposed to identify his broader area of interest. Then next part comes, within a broader area, he has to narrow down on a smaller part. For example, labor economics is a wider field. If it may be rural labor, may be urban labor, may be child labor, migrant labor, woman labor, so on which particular type of labor he wants to do the research. If he has identified that I want to do the research on child labor, then the question arises, there are various dimensions where there are various aspects of child labor. Maybe, why? whether child labor is due to the demand factor or due to the supply factor. That means whether it is a parental attitude that they send their children for the labor, or it is due to the cheap labor, their lower wages, cheaper labor, that the suppliers or the employers demand more child labor. So, or is the child labor is due to the poverty, or poverty is due to the child labor? So many issues come up. So once the topic is defined, then the dimensions or the particular aspects need to identify. Then another part comes the particular area. If it is a empirical research study, then one has to identify the area, whether that area will be all over country, or a state, or a district, or a particular block, or so many things, or a region. So it depends upon what type of study, what type of theme, what type of research questions he wants to examine. And then it also depends what type of data he wants to use. If he wants to conduct a case study type thing, then he is supposed, or he is expected to do some sort of primary survey, then area has to be narrowed down. And if he wants to study the macro aspects, the macro variables, then he may enlarge his area. Area may be region, district, state, or even a country. Then the next thing arises, a particular time dimension. If the problem is of empirical nature, then he has to identify the area also. It cannot be like that the productivity and wages for agriculture labor. He has to define the area also, in what particular period he will use the data. For example, if one wants to know the impact of this exchange rate on the IT sector, then he has to, the impact of globalization, then he has to identify the time, he has to define the time dimension, the period dimension. From a, for instance, he wants to know the impact of globalization, then he has to take some period before the globalization and then some period after the globalization, so that he can point out this is the impact of the globalization. So all these issues, the first thing is that he has to identify the broad area, then narrow down the area, particular topic, then come to the particular aspects, then particular to area, and then particular to time. He has to define the that this is how the topic is defined. And the next thing comes to define the two issues, research issues. He has to go through the entire literature and to identify what are the particular research issues, what are the particular research questions he wants to answer in his study. So all these things has to be done in a careful manner. Then how he should do it, because he is new in that area. Then the importance of review of literature comes. What he has to do is that he has to go through the relevant literature. The literature may be of two types. The literature may be theoretical literature, conceptual things, what particular theories have been formulated in that particular area, and then how the concepts have been defined, and then he has to also know the empirical literature. Empirical literature means that either on that particular problem or resembling to that problem, many other researchers might have undertaken so many research studies. So what particular research methodology have been used by that particular researcher or a group of researchers, he has to go through all that researches. And what are his findings and how he will do further research in that area. So he will be able to find out what is the gap, what he wants to do and what has already been done. This sort of things, this review of literature will enable to him to identify the gap between what is already known and what is to be known. So a researcher may find out by his research study to fill up that gap. This will only be possible when he critically, carefully go through the entire literature available on that particular theme. Literature as a both theoretical as well as empirical. So this another thing is that he can also discuss the issue, particularly identification of the research issues, with his supervisor, with his teachers, with his fellow colleagues, and with his own peer groups. Because many times from discussion so many things comes out, so he can take help the peer group as well. So library is an important part, that is why. And nowadays this internet, after coming this internet facility, he can also go through various research studies done across the world. So these are the things. The next things comes in the research process is the formulation of hypothesis. Once the research issues are clear in his mind and the topic is clear, he has to formulate a hypothesis. Now I come to, there is a little bit of confusion. Many students come, their hypotheses are of two types. One is a statistical hypothesis, another may be research hypothesis. Statistical hypothesis virtually in framing the research proposal has no much role. Because statistical hypothesis means we want to examine or to test a null hypothesis or an alternative hypothesis, which my colleagues in the earlier session have seen testing the hypothesis. Mind it that here hypothesis has, we refer to research hypothesis only. So research hypothesis has to be framed in such a manner that either it must relate some relations between the independent and dependent variables, some explanatory variables, some explained variables, so relating to the problem which you have framed. Another thing is that it is a basically tentative statement which is to be tested by the empirical evidences. While framing the hypothesis, one has to be very particular about two things. One, it must be a testable proposition. If somebody makes a hypothesis which cannot be tested, it has no relevance, it has no meaning. Second thing is that it must be a very carefully meant that it must explain some relationship in terms of explained and explanatory variables. And in a particular MPhil or PhD proposal, there are not be many hypotheses. Either it may be two or three, not more than three, because then it becomes difficult to test all the hypotheses. And then framing the hypothesis, what can be the basis? The basis can be either on the basis of the observation, because a researcher observed the things in the field, or it may be based on the logical thinking, reasoning based, or it may be framed on the basis by discussion with her peer groups or with his teacher or supervisor. So these are the aids which may be helpful in framing the research hypothesis. Another important point which you have to keep in mind, that research hypothesis must be consistent with the research questions, research issues which you have identified. It must have be consistent with the objectives. The research hypothesis is not be framed which do not have any relevance with the research issues or research questions which you have raised in your proposal. So these are the three important parts. Then I come to the next part, which is basically research design. What do we mean by research design? Research design is basically a blueprint, a project, or a planned manner of things how a researcher wants to do. For example, an architect makes first a project. He makes a whole plan or a map. So if he wants to make a building is not made all of a sudden. First of all, an architecture makes a map where will be how the whole building is to be constructed. So this is basically a blueprint, a map of the whole research scheme. How he will conduct the survey, how he will collect the data, what instruments will be used, what will be the size of sampling, which particular tool will be utilized or will be used in collecting the data, whether interview will be made, questionnaire will be sent, a semi-structured interview will be made, whether any enumerator will go in the field, or on what particular variables data will be collected, how the data will be processed, how data will be analyzed, which particular technique will be used for analysis of the data. All these things come under the research design. So carefully research design will enable a researcher or an investigator to complete the research in a meaningful manner. If the planning is not done in well in advance manner, in a careful manner, then he may not lead to a successful research study. So research design play a very important role in conducting a meaningful research. Then next part comes is collection of data. How data is collected? There are various methods. It may broadly there are primary survey method, secondary survey method, data is collected. These are used in quantitative research, but there are various methods for while conducting the qualitative research. It may be diary, sometimes records, sometimes maps, sometimes pictures, newspapers. All these type of tools are used in collecting the data. So data collection of data, which particular technique will be used, it depends on the availability of the time, cost, and the availability of the manpower, and broadly on the objective as well. What is the basically what are the objectives of a researcher? These also help him to identify the nature of data needed, the type of data is needed, and the method to collect the data. So we have given 1, 2, 3 units on this full things: collection of data, primary survey, secondary survey, sampling design, how a sampling is made. In unit 7 you will find detail about these things. So this is collection of data. The next question arises: analysis of data. Once the data is collected, it is collected in a very raw form. So data needs to be processed. How to be processed? First thing is the editing, because so many types of information questionnaire, some may be incomplete, some may be wrongly filled, and some information may not be arranged in a systematical manner. So a researcher has to first edit the data, then he has to codify the data, he has to give the code, because data has to be tabulated nowadays through computer. Computer needs that coding, so that coding is to be made. And then tabulation, because data has to be presented in tabular form, classify the data, data to be classified according, and then tabulation, then percentage worked out. So all this type of processes are included in the processing of the data. That once the data is processed, then the things come on the analysis of data. There are various techniques of data analysis. It may be a unidimensional, it may be a bivariate, it may be a multivariate. Analysis may be inferential data. Let me give brief about each of them. Unidimensional basically uses like measures of center tendency, like measures of skewness, and correlation, regression, time series, index number. These are unidimensional data. Then bivariate basically we use the correlation, regression, and two-way ANOVA analysis. And then multivariable analysis is basically multiple analysis. And then inferential is very important, because one has to estimate the parameter, one has to fit the model in the form of y is function of x. So that has to be a model is to be defined, y is equal to alpha plus beta x, and these things have been explained in the earlier session, so I need not to elaborate on that part. So these type of analysis techniques are used in analyzing the data. And then once the data has been analyzed, then a researcher is expected to write the report. There are various methods, layout plan, and then has to be presented in a particular format. So all these things have been discussed in our course material, because these have been separately dealt with in each unit. So you can consult our course material for this purpose. So then after giving this research process, then let me come to the research approaches part. Broadly, research approaches are of two types. One is quantitative, another is qualitative. And what is quantitative, what is qualitative, I have already explained to you. But within the quantitative approach, we have the three approaches. One is inferential approach, second is experimental approach, and third is simulation approach. Inferential approach, here basically we include the econometric models, because whatever results we have drawn on the basis of the data collected through sampling technique. That is, and we are applying those results to the our population, to the universe. So whether the results or whether the estimate of parameters which have been made on the basis of sampling data, does it apply to the population or not? So for that purpose, we put some test, which is known as hypothesis testing. We frame two types of hypothesis, null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis, and there are a particular set of rules, particular methods, which I will not elaborate upon because it has already been discussed in the earlier session. So this is called as inferential approach. Second approach is experimental approach. Under this approach, a particular environment is controlled, regulated, a particular variable is kept constant, and then we examine the impact of one variable over the other. For example, in two variable model, we have one independent variable that is called as y, another variable, two variable x1 or x2, and then one variable is kept constant, then its impact of the independent variable over dependent variable is examined by applying the particular set of techniques. So that sort of research is known as experimental approach. Then another approach is simulation approach. Under this approach, a particular environment, a particular artificial environment is created to know the impact about the attitude of the people. In science, in natural sciences, in this approach this approach is used in the laboratory experiments in laboratory by applying the laboratory techniques. But in social sciences, sometimes a behavior, how a particular environment, his behavior is influenced. Let me give an example. For example, if we want to organize the particular set of the laborers, then a particular technique, a particular play is, because they have to sensitize about their organization importance, how the unity or how organization among them help to achieve their common objectives, because generally the employers want to give them the lesser wages, poor working conditions, poor living conditions, retrenchment, layoff, etc., etc. So the poor people, because they are organized, they are at the mercy of the employer. So how the organization help them, to enable them, to empower them, both economically, educationally, a particular set of play is played among them, and they are taught that if they have been organized, they have been enabled to get these many advantages, these many benefits, that have enabled them to improve their working conditions, their living conditions. So this type of simulation approaches and such type of approaches to sensitize the people. So this is known as a simulation approach. After this, we will come to what is the fundamental difference between the quantitative approach as well as qualitative approach. Let me come to begin one by one. There are certain differences in qualitative research. Basically, we focus on the different method of data collection, different types of data tools, different types of analysis techniques, different timing, and all that thing. Let me come on the data collection method. Under quantitative approach, basically, we use the statistical techniques, very particular data collection methods like laboratory observations, questionnaires, schedules, interviews. Interviews are also used in qualitative techniques, but here we use a semi-structural interview. The meaning thereby that interview is not fixed in a particular fashion, it depends upon the situation to situation, and according to the situation, interviews are conducted. Similarly, here observation as a technique, as a tool for data collection is used, but here observation is a participant observation, whereas in quantitative approach, we use the laboratory observations. Similarly, here group discussion in qualitative research is used. Key informants as a tool are used, whereas these are not much important under the quantitative approach. And the second difference in these two approaches is that formulation of questions and answers. In quantitative approach, questions are basically closed door type of questions, a very already decided questions, and we also give the tentative answer, the expected answer. But in qualitative research, questions are not in a very rigid form, they are open-ended questions, because the perceptions of the people, opinion of the people, attitude of the participants is more important, and it is not possible if the questions are framed in a closed manner. So here the questions are very open-ended questions. Then third method is selection of the respondents. In quantitative approach, basically we select the respondents on the basis of the sampling basis, a very sampling design. It is not the arbitrariness or discretion plays a less role. The sampling is designed in such a manner that it is a random sampling. But in qualitative research, sampling technique is less preferred, because here who will provide the maximum information? Who is the right respondent who is well aware of a particular problem, the particular research problem? We give more weightage. So here basically some sort of purposive type of sampling, or the guiding force is that who will provide the more information. Then the next is timing. In quantitative method, the data collection, the timing of the data collection, the time of data analysis is different, meaning thereby that once the data is collected, it is processed and then analysis is done. But in qualitative researcher, both things happen simultaneously. That means data is collected and at the spot, at the place of research, data is also analyzed. The next question, next difference is application of standard methods of analysis. In the quantitative research, as I have already mentioned, the different statistical techniques like econometrics techniques, statistical techniques are used, whereas in qualitative research, the different types of methods, basically critical commenting approach, critical interpretative techniques are used. So I think these are the major differences. Then typical forms of analysis, because analysis also differs. Here basically focus is formulation of the theories, whereas in quantitative research approach, basically we test empirically whether a particular theory fits with the experience properly. So I think time is running. I have not received any questions, but doesn't matter. The theme was very important. I hope that you might have enlightened by this discussion. And with this sort of thing, let me summarize, if time permits me, that in this discussion, we have given the conceptual clarity about the research methodology, research methods, research techniques, and the tools of the data collection. Then we have also explained what is the research process, meaning by thereby what are the various steps which involved in framing a research proposal, and then what is the basic difference between the quantitative approach and the qualitative approach. So with this sort of things, I thank you for listening patiently.